So now I'm going to call up three panelists who are going to help assess or digest what we just saw very quickly, and then we're going to move to the next kind of 10 minutes of that session to talk about what they see as the biggest opportunities. Maybe it was some of the things we just saw, versions of what we just saw, or whole new territories in the enterprise. So come on up, guys. Chris Schaepe from Lightspeed. We got Forrest Baskett from NEA. Come on up, guys. And Peter Wagner, formerly of Accel, as an investor in Fusionio. And now, what firm are you with now?
It's really just me. Alpha Venturi is the
Alpha Venturi. You're out on your own.
Indeed.
Good stuff. Okay, guys. So first of all, I just wanted to start by asking you guys what you thought of some of the demos that we just saw, and maybe some constructive criticism about what their opportunities are. You haven't had a chance to cross-examine them, right, to ask how their sales are doing or potentials or some of their product phases that they've already gone through. But did anything strike you as particularly promising in those companies? Forrest?
Sure. I think one of the phrases that jumped out at me from the One Doc Way presentation was reimbursement landscape. I think that's significant because the company is really thinking about how do they get paid and where should they really try to insert themselves into the world, and looking at something where the reimbursement landscape is, quote, well-developed, unquote, means that they're really thinking about things the right way. They also had all of the usual important phrases about HIPAA compliance, security, et cetera, which means that I think they really do understand what they're doing, and they're potentially going to offer something that's useful and can get going in a pretty quick way. So I was impressed.
Anything else, guys, on that particular company, the One Doc Way?
Sure. You know what? I think it brings a lot of utility, and there's a lot of need for a product like this. I think advice to the team would be don't underestimate the amount of value that can be delivered to the doctor's office or other healthcare providers just by some simple things like scheduling. There are some analogs in software companies or SaaS companies that got started in very simple things like appointment scheduling for dentist office, for spas and things like that, that actually grew quite large. And so I think you can have a walk before you run strategy there, before you take on all the HIPAA compliance and security issues and privacy and integration with back-end reimbursement systems, to really get a footprint out there and grow incrementally. So I think there's a lot of potential in that deal.
Peter, anything else to worth saying about the technology or the business model?
I liked One Doc Way. I mean, I actually liked all three projects. So would congratulate all three teams. Some really good work there, and a lot of enthusiasm and energy going into it. Just to echo some of what Chris said there, though, I mean, a project like One Doc Way is going to live or die, I think, less with technology and more just by understanding some of the notoriously difficult adoption dynamics that exist in healthcare in general and with doctors' offices and independent practices in particular. And it looked like the team had a pretty good handle on that, so I was encouraged.
Anything else in terms of breaking through on the distribution side? I mean, if that's your main criticism, what would you recommend they do given what they've just said? Because you said they addressed
it. It seems like the ones, the companies targeting that market that I've seen have sort of the best chance of success are trying to do something very simple, very broad, and very digestible. So they're not trying to go and really build the perfect machine on day one, but they're charging a low price. They're keeping the adoption barriers very surmountable for the average practice, and then building on the back of footprint as opposed to on the back of highly advanced functionality.
Great. What about DiffBot? Or Teamit, or Sococo, which is the last company that wasn't a student company. Any thoughts, guys?
Sure. I like Teamit. Initially, it looked like they were kind of all over the map, very rich, kind of mind-blowing experience. But in fact, it looked like buried in there was a potential to keep track of employee feedback and performance. One of the really huge problems for a growing company is how do you manage employees, and how do you do performance reviews, and how do you do all that terrible management stuff that nobody wants to do? And if you can, in fact, build something that is fun to use and potentially gives you a way to grab that information without it seeming like so much work, there's real potential there. And that means that that kind of software could feed into the software systems that do employee management, which is a really big field.
So, Forrest, you're talking about the huge opportunity. Guys, are they going about it the right way? Is there anything you'd say about their approach that you could give them constructive criticism on that side?
Either I think one of the things is Forrest pointed out, there's a lot of bells and whistles there. What is the positioning of this offering? You know, is it more like a box.net sharing information and data, or is it more like a Facebook that's geared toward the enterprise? I think something that may help the adoption curve here is to really try to identify the killer apps that are low-hanging fruit, easy to use, will deliver a lot of value, whether it's, as Forrest said, HR issues. It could be recruiting, interviewing, sharing notes on candidates, could be training for certain purposes. But positioning and being very clear about that will be important because there's a lot of competition, a lot of noise in that space.
Yeah, I mean, it read to me like something that would broadly fit into the category of, enterprise social. And I guess my own view on enterprise social is that this is not a standalone application category, but really a backbone service that needs to pervade existing application categories. And, as such, will be something that you see as a capability or a layer of functionality within your functional systems. So, when I saw TeamIt, it was hard for me to really position it properly. Was it aspiring to be that backbone service? Was it trying to be a new functional service that was going to, sort of carve out its own niche? Was it a spin on a talent management type of service? It wasn't 100% clear to me, but I think with a little bit of focus, there could be a path in one of those directions.
Diff Bot and Sococo.
I really like the technology of DiffBot and what they could potentially do and how powerful that was. I was concerned about their targeting. Software developers have some characteristics that we all know about. One, there aren't enough of them. And two, they don't spend much money. So I was worried about that a bit. On the other hand, it did seem like the technology there could lead to some capabilities around deep search in the web, so that how to use those tools to build something that had a lot more value than just the tool itself. And that's what I would look for if I were going to really go after the DiffBot technology.
Interesting. Guys, would you second that? Is it deep search is the answer for DiffBot?
Well, I would second Forrest's observation that it was cool technology and that the perfect use of it wasn't necessarily clear, although I think there probably are a lot of possibilities. The business, these API-based business models where you're targeting a developer who's going to pay you to utilize your API, I think are interesting, but the ones that succeed best seem to be the ones where the end user is actually paying real money for the operation or the transaction that's utilizing the API. So I would call out, something like Twilio, for example. People are used to paying for minutes of telecom, and so there's some money that can be shared there. It wasn't clear to me whether the developers that would be necessarily hitting the DiffBot API, whether they were going to be on media business models or some other business model that was going to have a little gross margin to be shared. So
great.
I think there's maybe a little more poking around to do there to zero in on that.
Great. I want to get to Sococo, but Chris, do you have any thoughts on either of those statements on DiffBot?
Yeah, I would say I've seen a number of companies like this in the past, and they can be somewhat bimodal, and the devil's really in the details here as to what is the barrier to entry and how good is the tool. Is there something on the margin that makes this tool much better than competing tools in the market? And if that is the case, you can sometimes see these, what would appear to be a specialized or niche product, actually gain a fairly wide footprint and spread quite rapidly through word of mouth in the developer community. One example was a company called Pure Software. This is dating back probably to the mid-90s. They fixed memory leaks in software programs, and that sounds fairly arcane, but They grew to be quite large because they were just exceptional in what they did. And if this company has those hooks and the differentiation, they have a chance to really become quite broadly used.
Great. Sococo, that's a pretty interesting company. It's almost doing everything around communications in the enterprise, which is why we're here. What do you guys think of their product and its offering?
I really like the categories. I think the whole notion of cloud-based collaboration for business users is a rich one. There have been many attempts before, and it is not necessarily that easy, as Chris said, to differentiate yourself. I thought, you know, there was an interesting range of functionality in the Sococo product, biting off a lot, though. Just the real-time part that they were demoing and announcing today is significant, and so I think it's, you know, it's a great category. For this particular demo, I thought it looked interesting, but there's a fair amount of clutter.
What's stopping you guys from investing in Sococo?
Well, echoing Peter, I think it's a crowded space. Collaboration tools, there are a lot of them. There are a lot of different kinds. What Sococo is trying to do is, at the heart of it, it's media integration. And that's kind of an interesting problem all by itself. And it shows up in a lot of different places. And if they can do a really good job of media integration, solve a lot of thorny problems with media integration, then maybe there's something there. But just as a collaboration tool in and of itself, I would worry about getting into that market, finding a wedge in.
Chris?
Yeah, I think the adoption of a tool like this, it's a little bit of a chicken and the egg. You have to have multiple people in the organization buying into it and using it religiously. It doesn't sort of work if half the people really want to use it and half don't. I think I might have seen this company before in an earlier incarnation. It was probably ahead of its time, you know, with things like Skype and collaboration and video becoming more popular. It's possible the time is beginning to be right for an idea like this, but it will require buy-in, and it's got to be better than a nice-to-have. It's got to find an application use case that really is a must-to-have, and I think it can help distributed workforces find a better sense of community and belonging to a team if they use a tool like this. But I think human behavior is hard to change, and it'll take a while for people to get used to working in this manner.
Great, guys. I mean, that's wonderful feedback. I wish we had more time to go into some of the bigger trends that you guys are seeing. We've only got a little less than 5 minutes, but I'd still like to try. You know, we've come a long way. I mean, demo was a place where Salesforce launched, many years ago, and Fusionio we've been talking about it. A lot of the companies here are of the same ilk, a little more front end. Now, I know you guys are focused. A lot of you are focused on the back end, right? So serious storage and networking software plays. I'd like to open this up just maybe since we have such little time. One major, big honking trend that you guys think has the most opportunity that you're investing in. I mean, what companies are you looking for that you think, with enough specificity that you're looking for to invest in? Forrest?
Well, that's a tough one. The best ideas, investment ideas that I've found are ones that I've stumbled upon as opposed to thought up. Fusion.io is a good example. But I think the cloud services is really only started to develop into what it can be down the road. We're moving away from an era where we had individual units of software and hardware and appliances and stacks of this and that's. And I think the cloud's going to change all that in fundamental ways that we've only just scratched the surface on. So spending a lot of time looking at that.
Great. We saw a lot of communication and video stuff. It's associated with the front end. Peter, you got any thoughts in terms of what that means for the back end handling? We hear a lot about video pushing a drive to more, need more bandwidth.
Sure.
What do you think about the opportunities that are being driven by things like video?
Yeah, well, I think video is you got to be clear what types of video you're talking about. There's sort of real-time two-way video of the sort that would be used in a collaboration context. you know, then there's just entertainment video, the media product itself. And, you know, we spoke a bit about the collaborative aspect and how there's good opportunity there. But on, you know, just on the media aspect of video, I think there's a whole, both from the content and its creation through its delivery, through its consumption. I mean, this too is going to be an area where, there's a lot of investable opportunity. I've personally been focusing on the delivery side of that. I think it's been an overlooked aspect where you have, the rise of over-the-top video services, both on mobile networks as well as wireline networks, and what that means for the delivery chain is really pretty terrifying if you dig into the details. So that's one aspect where I think you'll see a lot of good old-fashioned technology opportunity as well as the opportunity to provide services that ease a lot of that pain, especially on the mobile side. If I was going to cite one thing, though, I mean, I think I'd have to, sort of echo what Forrest was talking about in terms of this being, the first inning for cloud-based services. And, this is the biggest transformation of enterprise platforms we've ever seen. I mean, I think a number of us have lived through platform transitions in the past, whether it's mainframe to client server or the move to the virtual platform. But this move to the cloud is bigger. And the reason it's bigger is because the prior transitions just kind of changed the nature of the assets that corporate IT was owning and operating. This time, corporate IT is getting out of the asset O&O business and into the service definition and consumption business. And that, I think, is the biggest change to hit enterprise IT, at least in my career.
Interesting. Chris?
Yeah, so underlying all this, I like to look for areas of disruption and discontinuity, and we're seeing a number of those develop. One area I think is particularly interesting is how the whole networking industry is evolving. You're seeing some of the incumbents like Cisco and Juniper lose a lot of good people and ready for new innovation. And some of the action there is all around software-based networking or network virtualization, taking some of the ideas that have been applied in the computing space in the past, applying them to networking, making the networks and network services more fluid, more scalable and agile to support these cloud services. So I believe that you'll see a lot of proliferation of new ideas and new startups there, and probably a greater proliferation of angel-based funding in that space, really following what's happened in the social and internet space from all the Cisco and Juniper and so forth alumni club out there that are, have the capacity to fund and the willingness to get involved in new projects.
Yeah, I noticed in your comments, I've just got less than a minute to wrap up, that as I thought, you guys are really focused more on the back end, your cloud, the biggest disruptions going on behind. But one of the main themes we heard tonight and we've heard so far is the consumerization of the enterprise, right? Which is I think easier for the typical, the traditional developer to move over from say consumer technology and address that, right? You're thinking about companies like Dropbox and Box, and Excelion just got, I think, $10 million to be the Dropbox of the enterprise. Is that played out, or is there still a lot of opportunity for things in that area?
I don't think that's played out at all. I mean, I think Dropbox is a great example of a phenomenally useful service that has a great following and tremendous adoption. Yet many enterprises, are somewhat concerned about its usage within their organization because it creates a number of issues for them in terms of compliance, governance, regulatory issues, security issues. So, I believe there's a great opportunity to leverage the things that make Dropbox so useful to the end user and then equip that service, hopefully Dropbox itself, not a reinvention, with the capabilities that allow it to be comfortably usable for the enterprise at scale. And
right.
I think that thesis alone can probably lead to four or five really big businesses at least, and maybe more.
Thanks, Peter. Unfortunately, we're out of time, but you've got a 15-second wrap-up, guys, on what Peter just said?
Sure. I've actually seen startups that are targeting adding capabilities to Dropbox to provide some of those capabilities that the enterprise needs that they just don't get. So,
great.
It's a great
idea. There's a mobile overlay on that as well. A lot of action that's happening there. So, I think we're in the second inning of that whole wave of innovation.
So, Matt, can I add one last thought?
Yeah.
Okay.
15 seconds.
You got it. Okay. So, So this move to the cloud that we've been talking about, parting thought for the crowd. The move to the cloud as the way that most of us are going to consume IT, even with our business user hats on, is antithetical to the business models of most of the existing enterprise IT vendors. So if you are Oracle, if you are Cisco, if you are Network Appliance, if you are EMC, you have a problem because your old business model, which consists of very high gross margins to fund lots of R&D and very fancy sales and marketing, is not going to fit well with the type of customer that is purchasing cloud infrastructure and provisioning cloud-based services. That needs to be fixed for this to be a healthy industry, and it may not be the incumbents that come up with the solution.
Great note to end on. Thank you, guys. Thank you very much.